ओम सहनावतु सहनो भुनक्तु तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहैः। ओम शांति शांति शांति। ओम सदाशिवसमारंभां शंकराचार्यमध्यमां अस्मदाचार्यपर्यन्तां वंदे गुरुपरंपरां श्रुतिस्मृतिपुराणानां आलयं करुणालयं नमामि भगवत्पादं शंकरं लोकशंकरं समस्तजनकल्याणे निरतं करुणामयं नमामि चिन्मयं देवं सद्गुरुं ब्रह्मविद्वरं सर्ववेदान्तसिद्धान्तगोचरं तमगोचरं गोविन्दं परमानन्दं सद्गुरुं प्रणतोऽस्म्यहम्। So the questions that the student asked, seven questions, and about bondage, how is it formed, how is it sustained, how to get free from it, what is Atma, what is Anatma, and how to distinguish between both these. When the student has asked such questions, the teacher glorifies the student's seeking, and he says, Dhanyosi Krita Krityosi, you are blessed, you are fulfilled. So he says, you are blessed and you are fulfilled. Why? Because when we use the human body for seeking the self, that is what is the best use of this human birth. So Dhanyosi, blessed you are. You are doing what needs to be done. And you have purified your whole kula. Pavitam te kulam tvaya. See, one who realizes the truth definitely purifies the whole kula. But here is somebody who has just asked the question. It is not just for the sake of the question, but it is also because the student has that kind of a discriminative intellect. So the student has that kind of a discriminative intellect, and the student is on the path. Very few people take up to this path. And a person who comes onto the path will definitely reach the goal. And when a person has the guidance of a Sadguru, is putting the effort, which is what the next portion will be, that person will reach the goal. So anticipating that, the teacher is already congratulating the student that you have purified your whole kula also. Pavitam te kulam tvaya. Why? Ya davidya bandha muktya brahmi bhavitum icchati. Well, icchasi. That you want to become Brahman. Very few people have that desire. And that also the right means is by getting out of ignorance. Bondage created by ignorance. So the student knows what is the goal exactly is to know my own self. What is actually binding me is my own ignorance. And to get out of that, he has come to the teacher asking such questions about the cause of bondage, how to be free, etc. Hence the teacher praises the student. Then he takes up the next section, which is the glory of self-effort. So two examples we saw yesterday. There are three actually in this sequence. So first example, verse 51, we saw that if a father has taken debt and is pressurized because of that, some loan for education of the children or to buy a home or a car or anything, and the father is not able to repay, is under a lot of stress, tension, the family members, children, they can help him out. Now in this, the debt also is external. The help that the children gave also is external. And the consequent stress which is inside is reduced. Example given here is that external debt can be removed by others, but the delusion which is inside about bondage, about one's own body, about wrong identification, that they cannot help to remove. That one has to do by oneself. That was first example. So the burden on the head can be removed by somebody else. That's the second example. If somebody is carrying a big load, then some people can help to offload it. But the burden that is inside, that cannot be removed by people. The weight of the ego that one is carrying, the weight of one's attachments. Now we sometimes do this experiment. When I do the youth empowerment program, so there is one, when we speak about attachment, love, detachment, one simple activity we do, we tie up two people together. There's a 2 feet rope and they are tied, right hand of one person and left hand of the other person. And they have to be together throughout the day. Except when they use the restroom, at that time that person leaves the bondage, goes inside, the other person has to wait outside. Whole day they are like that. That activity has a lot of learnings. Just one attachment, one person is attached to you and there is so much of restriction on one's own freedom. Imagine the attachments which we carry in the mind, that's such a load. Constantly that drains our mind. So he says that the load that one is carrying internally of ignorance, attachment, that nobody can help to remove. That one has to put effort by oneself. So these two examples that we saw yesterday, the second example, we also have the example of hunger. That the hunger pang which is inside, that nobody can help to relieve. So the load outside, somebody can help to unload, but the hunger, I have to eat food for my hunger. Now comes the third example. Patyam aushadha sevacha kriyate yena rogina arogya siddhir drishtasya nanya nushthita karmana. So if one has fallen sick, rogina, then one has to do patya and aushadhi. Patya is all the restrictions that are prescribed by the doctor so that the symptom doesn't aggravate. And aushadhi is the medicine which is given so that a person can be cured. Patyam aushadha seva. So both these, who has to do? Yena rogina. The person who is sick has to follow that. Arogya siddhe drishtasya. Only then the person will become healthy. Nanyanushtita karmana, not by any amount of seva and other things that people do. So somebody can help. Suppose there is a fever that someone has, temperature is running very high. Somebody can help to put, you know, cold water napkins on the head, massage the feet, apply some balm, all that they can help to do. But the diet restriction, one has to follow. Medicine, one has to eat. That nobody else can do. So these are three examples. In the same way, the roga that we have, the bhava roga that we have, the patya and aushadhi, patya is the preparation, the 10 qualities that we saw. Sadhan chatushtaya plus bhakti. Those 10 qualities one has to prepare. And aushadhi is Brahmagnyan, Shravan Manan Nididhyasan. These two one has to do by, take by oneself. One cannot be, somebody else cannot do that for a person. So these three examples, all to explain about self-effort. Each one is subtler than the previous one. In the first one, there is a debt which is external. The help which is given also is external. In the second one, it is said about the load on the head. Somebody can help to remove, but hunger inside, nobody can help to remove. The third one, there is a disease inside, and the cure and the medicine as well as the restrictions, both have to be followed by a person inside. All the three are to glorify that effort has to be put by an individual. And in Vedanta, the effort is very subtle. So it is said there are three types of bondages. One is called the physical bondage, sahaj. So if somebody has bound me physically, I can put effort and get out of it. So physical bondage removed by physical effort. Second bondage is the bondage caused by attachment. Karmic bondage it is. That is more mental. So where I am attached to a person, attached to a thing, attached to a type of situation, and my happiness depends on that. So now that attachment is not a physical attachment. It is a thought bondage. Gurudev used to call it as thought bondage. One has to put that effort by oneself to detach, to be secure in oneself, to turn the mind towards the higher. One has to put that effort. Pratipaksha bhavana. One has to do all that. But the third level of bondage is Bhrantija. Sahaj, Karmaj and Bhrantija. Bondage which is created by Bhranti is not a real bondage. So how do we get out of that Bhrantija? By right vision, by seeing clearly. If I am seeing a snake instead of a rope, and I am feeling that this snake has bit me and now I am going to die. There's a lot of agitation in the mind. So that will not go by any amount of action or effort externally. That will go by effort internally, where I have to shift. The vision has to change, where I have to examine clearly, okay, what is that? And to examine clearly, the mind must be fully available. So the self-effort is to prepare one's mind and then to see clearly. The seeing clearly is a very subtle effort. Preparation is still easy compared to seeing clearly. In seeing clearly, what does one do? Withdraw the senses, focus on the mind, try and contemplate steadily on the self, and go beyond the mind. Now this self-effort is subtle effort. Externally, one will not see a person doing anything. Gurudev used to say that a Buddha sitting below a tree looks idle. He doesn't do anything. He's as though he's wasting his time. Another example he used to give is that Michelangelo, when he is sitting on the banks of a lake, and he is observing the lake, the change of the pattern on the water as the breeze blows. Through the day when the time changes, the reflection, how the change happens in the water. If you put a stone, the ripples that are created. So it will look that he is simply sitting on the banks of the river and just whiling away his time. But actually he is doing intense work. He is observing that whole thing, and then a masterpiece comes out. So like that, he two examples where externally it seems that nothing is being done by this person, but internally a lot of work is happening. So in Vedanta also it is the same, that Bhrantija, the delusion born, the bondage born out of delusion, Bhrantija Karma, Bandhan. That can go only by right vision, right seeing. And for that, the last example is the best one. The roga is inside. Like health is our natural state. Disease is not our natural state. In the same way, Sachidananda is our natural state. Ego is not our natural state. Now to get out of that, just like the student, just like the patient takes some medicine and is resting. Externally is doing nothing, resting. But there's tremendous things happening inside. Then the root cause of this disease is being attacked and person becomes healthy again. In the same way, when a person goes to the teacher, puts the hard work, if he has done the hard work already to prepare the tenfold, ten qualities, that is great. Then comes the subtler self-effort of Shravan Manan Nididhyasana. Otherwise, one has to do both. And all this requires hard work inside, subtle work. That's why Gurudev used to say that religion is not the last resort of the dejected, depressed and the despondent. Many people think like that. That there's nothing better to do, okay, become a sadhu. But it requires a lot of hard work. So now, having said about this self-effort, the three examples that he gives, then he goes on to speak about this clarity that one requires. And because why he brought out the topic of self-effort? Because this requires subtle purusharth. So that he comes up in the next verse, verse number 54. Vastu rupam suta bodha chakshusha svenaiva vedyam natu panditena chandraswarupam nija chakshushaiva natavyamanyairavagamyate kim. So he says vastu rupam. So vastu, the word vastu here means the self. Many places the word self, word vastu will mean self. Otherwise vastu means a thing. This is the language, Sanskrit language. The same word is used to represent things which are inert, vastu, and the self which is sentient. So vastu rupam. So how will I know what is the nature of the self? The language has that elasticity to accommodate both contrary meanings. So like Vignesha. Vignesha means both. One who is the lord of obstacles, who helps to remove obstacles. And also one who puts obstacles. He puts obstacles on the path of people doing adharma. He puts obstacles on the path of people doing dharma also, so that they will become stronger. So it means both. The same word means remover of obstacle also and one who adds obstacles also. Same way here, vastu rupam. The nature of the self. How will you know? Sfuta bodha chakshusha. By clear seeing. Sfuta bodha chakshusha. Sfuta means clear. Bodha is knowledge. Chakshu is eyes. The knowledge arising by clear seeing will help me to know the nature of the self. Svenaiva vedyam. That has to be known by oneself only. Natu panditena. Not by anybody else or not by any scholarly approach. Chandraswarupam nija chakshushaiva. The beauty of the moon has to be experienced by oneself. One has to go out of the room in the night, look up and experience what is the glory and the beauty of the moon and why it is so fascinating for all people. Jnatavya manyai ravagamya tekim. How will it be known by description of anybody else? Meaning, just like the beauty of the moon, the full moon has to be experienced by oneself. No amount of words, no amount of poet's description can make that person experience what the real beauty of the moon is, unless that person actually goes out. The description of others is only to create that desire and that enthusiasm, okay, I also want to go and experience. In the same way, what the Shastra speaks, what the other people give talks on, is mainly to create that desire that I also want to experience that self. Just like the moon's beauty, one wants to go and experience. So Purnima is a symbol of fullness, completeness. Moon, the symbol of the mind. So when the mind is transcended, when we experience Purnata, what will be that state? The Upanishads, the lives of saints, the Vedas, all these are to make that person aware that your own nature is that. And to create that desire that you must know this self. And how will you know the self? By clear seeing. Sphuta Bodha Chakshusha. Shankaracharya ji calls it Samyak Darshan. In the commentaries that he gives, he calls it a Samyak Darshan. Clear seeing. What is the meaning of clear seeing? Clear seeing means where there is no obstacle between the seer and the seen. And where the seer and the seen become one, then the knowledge arises. Where the seer and the seen duality is gone. That is called clear seeing. Even in our day-to-day life it happens. Now if I am seeing this computer, the seer through the mind, the mind through the eyes goes out, sees the computer. The impression is created on my eyes. Lateral inversion happens and that I see. And then image is there in the mind. And the knowledge is there in the intellect that this is called as a computer. So the seer is contacting the seen. And there are no obstacles. If there is something in between, I can't see. If there is a dust particle in the eye, I can't see. If the eye is not capable of seeing, then again I can't see. If the mind is wandering, the eye is seeing, but knowledge is not arising. If the eye is seeing, mind is still there, but I don't know that this is called computer, then again the knowledge will not arise. So all these obstacles have to go. Then the seer and the seen, when they contact, they become one. In Vedanta, that is called the theory of perception. How do we see perception? Pratyaksha, how do we experience the things? Consciousness riding on the mind goes out through the senses, envelopes the object. Then the knowledge arises in the mind. So the person actually is seeing this whole thing because of the light of consciousness. And that seer and the seen have become one. Then the knowledge is arising. Because the seer only envelops the seen and knows that, oh, this is a computer. That thought has to rise, the vritti has to rise. Then the knowledge will arise. And in that knowledge, the distinction that I am the seer, this is a computer, goes. The knowledge straight away arises of the computer. At that time, I'm not consciously aware of these identities. The divisions are broken of the subject and the object. Only when subject-object division goes, actually knowledge will arise. Especially in the case of self, because at least in other case, there is externally an object and there is a mind. So there is a process. But here, it is not a process like that, that I'm trying to know something else. Here, I'm trying to know my own self, Vastu Rupa. Like the dreamer and the waker, they are not two different entities. The actor and the person who is playing the role, they are not two different entities. So there is no external seeing, but there is an internal shift in the vision. And that is what requires detachment from the scene. The actor, if the person is very, very attached to the role of the actor, for that person to see that I am not this actor, I am that person, that requires that detachment, hard work, effort to detach. And then to say that I am not this, but I am that, that is called Sruta Bodha Chakshusha, where the effort is to recognize. That's why Gurudev used to say this. Recognize word is recognize. So our cognition has to just shift. There's no externalization here. There is internally a shift that I am this, I am not this. So that one has to keep doing. And in that, whatever obstacles come, one removes. So as of now, it looks as though self is other than me. That's the extroverted mind which makes everything objectified. So through Vivek, Vairagya, etc., we prepare the mind for this clarity. That the self is not something out, it is my nature, and in fact that is me, this is not. And when I realize that, that's why it's called Tattvam Asi, that thou art. When I realize that thou art, now that will become Aham, Aham Brahmasmi. And what will happen to what I am seeing, considering as me now? It will not be there. It will disappear. It will all be as though it's an expression of the one truth. So the different that I am seeing right now in the mind, the spiritual vision, that difference will go away. So Vastu Rupam Sphuta Bodha Chakshusha. Svenaiva Vedyam. That's why one has to do this by oneself. This shift of the vision, this removal of the distinction between seer and the seen, all that has to be done by oneself. Other things can create a desire for this. Like the description of the moon can create the desire that I want to go and see the moon. You know, in the commentary, Gurudev has given a very, very nice paragraph about this description, about the moon, the vision of the moon. So he says here, the beauty, the brilliance, the soft glory, the queenly dignity, the serene consolation, the message of love and leisure, of peace and quietude, which the moon sheds as it glides across the springtime skies, cannot indeed be captured in words, but are experiences to be enjoyed subjectively only. The vision of its majesty is to be perceived by one's own eyes and experienced in satisfying suggestive silence. Such a nice line. Satisfying suggestive silence. A blind man cannot enjoy the love message of a moonlight, moonlit night. So one has to make the mind available, go out and just see what is the beauty of this moon. Now he compares this to our heart. When the self rises in the dark bosom of our ignorance and glides across the horizon of our experiences, that experience cannot be described fully to us by another, even though he may have experienced it himself. Each must experience it for himself, in himself. Such a beautiful one. In the dark, it's true, our heart is filled with ignorance, so there's darkness. In that, the moonrise happens. So both the sun and the moon in this context are symbolic of Purnata. So when the moon rises, the beauty of that has to be experienced by oneself. So this is the glory of this self-effort. Why this self-effort the student has to put? How subtle is the effort? And the teacher is preparing the student. Now, having given these three examples of self-effort as well as of the moon, one aspect here to understand is that the self-effort here is of the nature of dropping. The self-effort here is not of the nature of acquiring. In the world, when we have a goal, we have an ambition, we want to achieve something, and we say, you must put hard work, effort. So we go out, do actions consistently with determination, fortitude. We go out and achieve. That is to acquire something that I don't have. When we speak about the self, it is not something to be acquired which I don't have. It is my nature. Then why am I not knowing it? Why am I not experiencing it? Because I don't know. So ignorance is the cause. And that's why the word used here is sphuta bodha chakshusha. That one has to know it by one's own self-effort, by clarity. So the effort that has to be put here is not the effort to do something. It is the effort to drop sphuta bodha. As we spoke earlier, the obstacles which are there, they have to be removed. No, but what about the effort to learn, to listen, to reflect? Is it not doing something? It appears it is doing something, but actually it is dropping. The false notions are being dropped by reflection. You know, Gurudev used to say that Shravan, Manan, Niridhyasan. They will remove the three obstacles. Shravan will remove, I don't know. Manan will remove, I can't understand. Niridhyasan will remove, I can't experience. So they are to remove, they are to drop. Drop the wrong notions, drop the attachments, and drop the contrary feeling that I am this body. Drop all those. So that the nature of the self-effort here is to drop. That results in the clear vision. So sphuta bodha chakshusha. And that's why this has to be done by oneself. Because if it is something to be acquired, then yes, somebody can help. But anything that is acquired will not stay for long because it's temporary. What is already there with me is a permanent. Only the obstacles to knowing it have to be removed. So sphuta bodha chakshusha. Now he goes on to say that what is that bondage? When he spoke here about sphuta bodha chakshusha, he introduces now the technical word, the technical aspect of bondage in 55th one. Avidya kama karma adi pasha bandham vimochitum kashaknu yadvinatmanam kalpa koti shatairapi. So he says here, avidya, kama, karma. These three are called as the hridaya granthi, the knots of the heart. Avidya, kama, karma, adi, pasha bandham vimochitum. To be free from the bondage caused by these. Avidya, kama and karma. Ka shaknuyad. Who is capable? Vina atmanam, except oneself, who is capable of making a person get out of this bondage caused by avidya, kama, karma? Kalpa koti shatairapi. In hundreds and crores of kalpas. Again, this is to explain about the importance of effort that we have to put. Nobody will help. Even in hundreds and crores of kalpas, one kalpa is equal to four yugas. Satyug, Tretayug, Dwaparyug, Kaliyug. So Kaliyug, 4,32,000, 8,64,000 is Dwaparyug, 17,34,000 something is, 8,64,000 is 17,00,000, some 28 or something, whatever, some number it is. And then 34,00,000 something is Satyug. That is one kalpa. He says 100 crores of kalpas also, nobody can help. Why? Because it is the granthi of my heart. Hridaya granthi it is. So these three, avidya, kama, karma, what ignorance cycle that we learnt about. Ignorance leads to false identification with the body, which makes me feel incomplete. And then because of my feeling of incompleteness, I have vasanas, which manifest as desires, thoughts, actions, results, which further strengthen the vasana. This avidya cycle is, in short, summarized by three words, avidya, kama and karma. ignorance, desire, and action. So ignorance, desire, and action, these are what bind us. Technically, when he is asking what is bondage, no other bondage except this avidya, kama, and karma. What truly binds? Even the other attachments that we have, they are a product of this only. Whether I'm attached to somebody or I'm attached to an object or some situation, it is a product of this karma, constant brooding that leads to that attachment. And then I will do karma to get that object of attachment. So avidya, kama, and karma, these three, they are called the Hridaya Granthi, and a person is freed from these at the time of realization alone. Vidyate Hridaya Granthi, Chidyante Sarva Samshayaha, Kshiyante Chasya Karmani, Tasmin Drishte Paravare. That's a beautiful mantra from Mundaka Upanishad. Vidyate Hridaya Granthi, the knot of the heart is pierced, is destroyed, shredded. Chidyante is cut asunder. It's a knot, now it ties. So what is really making me bound is not anybody outside, no government, no person, no situation, no object. It is my own ignorance and the resultant desire and the resultant actions. These are shackles. So, chidyante sarva samshaya. All doubts are cut asunder that how can I be the self, etc. And kshiyante chasya karmani. All karmas also get away. When person realizes, tasmin drishte paravari. So, what is the nature of this bondage? Avidya, kama, and karma. Not knowing the self is the avidya. That is the first root cause of bondage. And because of that, when I think that I am this individual and I want to be happy, to feel complete, I want to eat something, I want to go somewhere, I want to do this, I want to do that. That desire which is compulsive, that compulsiveness of the desire is the bondage. Ignorance of the self is bondage, compulsiveness of desire is bondage. Till the body is there, desires will remain. The difference between the master and the others is the master's desires are not for gratification. Master's desire is only for selfless service. No more the master has the notion that I need this for my happiness. That is gone. So by itself, the desire is not going to be a problem. It is a desire born out of ignorance that is a problem. Hence avidya and then kama. We generally think that desire by itself is the root cause of evil. No, ignorance born desire is the root cause of evil. The desire which is there, otherwise how will people like Shankaracharya ji revive the culture? It's because of a desire that I must serve this culture. But they don't have any selfish interest in that. They don't want any self-glorification out of that. They don't want any praise out of that. So that desire is not a bondage. That's why we have to be clear, this each one is the cause of the next one. Avidya is the cause of karma. Avidya is the cause of kama and kama is the cause of karma. So actions born out of selfish desires are selfish actions. Those will be the cause of bondage. So desires are cause of bondage because on them depends my happiness. And because the desires are not going to be fulfilled in the same life, they become the cause of birth and death. Because we will do some karma and those karmas will not give result immediately. But because I am the karta, I have to be the bhokta. So I will have to again take birth to experience the result of my action. Some which I get the results immediately, fine, no problem. But those which I don't get immediately, to experience those, I have to again take birth. So desire becomes the cause. Ignorance born desire becomes the cause of transmigration. And how this transmigration is sustained? Because of this karma. grass karma also. So the karma bandhan is prarabdha karma, agami karma, sanchit karma. The total bank of my karma is called prarabdha karma. Out of that, some portion is ready to give me result, for which I take a body, that is called prarabdha karma. And while going through that, the new karmas that I am adding, that is the agami karma, which have not given results, that is called the agami karma. Now these three, they are the karma bandhan. So ignorance, desire, action. All three are subtle. What we just now spoke, no? Bhrantija is ignorance. Then karmaja is the third one. And the physical one, sahaj, that is external. So this is the bondage, that which is created by ignorance, which is created by desire, which is created by karma. Pasha bandham vimochitum. Now who will help me to come out of this? I only have to put my efforts, make my karma selfless, make my desires more sattvic, and I will ultimately get the self-knowledge, become free. So, ka shaknu yad vinatmanam kalpa koti shatairapi. This is about the self-effort. Verses number 51 to 55, with three analogies, as well as the analogy of the moon, and then this verse. They all are to make a person aware that there is a lot of self-effort that one has to put in, and one should not become complacent in this. Many people think that if we come to spiritual life, there will be complacency, but there is no space for complacency in spiritual life. There is only higher and higher, subtler and subtler evolution and subtler effort that one keeps putting. Now he comes to the knowledge of the self, the beauty of the self-knowledge. Because why will I put this effort? If I know the beauty of this self-knowledge, the glory of this Brahma Vidya, how is this self attained? Then I will strive, like the description is given. No? The moon's description, when it is given, then it creates the desire to go out and see. In the same way, when the description of the beauty of this self-knowledge is given, the glory of self-knowledge is given, it will create more and more desire that I want to know this self. And also the means becomes more and more clear, that the knowledge of the self is the only method to know the self. The liberation cannot be attained by any other method except knowledge of the self. So that section we will take up on Monday, the knowledge of the self. Any questions? You are welcome to ask.
Swamiji, you said about dropping self by I don't know, manan, I can't understand, and what is nididhyasana?
I can't experience.
I can't experience.
Yes. I don't experience the self right now. I think I am the body. So though the knowledge is I am the self, my experience is I am this jiva. Anadi mayaya sukta. From so many lives I have been carrying this feeling that I am the jiva. So that is called viparita bhavana. It doesn't go. The feeling that I am the jiva doesn't go unless one does steady contemplation. So through nididhyasana, the viparita bhavana is reversed, that I can't experience the self. I still feel I am the body. That's the viparita bhavana. Intellectually, I know. I am convinced because I have done manan. So there is intellectual clarity that I am the self, I am not the body, but the habitual error I am making again and again, that I still feel I am this body. So I can't experience the self. So that is called, that is removed by nididhyasana.
Thank you, Swamiji.
Swamiji, can you please tell the 10 things that are to be done along with Shravan, Manan and Nididhyasana? I would like to note it down.
They are the what is said in the Vivek Chudamani already before, no? The fourfold qualification. So Vivek is discrimination, Vairagya is dispassion, Shatka Sampatti, sixfold values. So these become eight. Mumukshutvam is nine and Bhakti is 10. The qualifications which are given, no? Which one has to cultivate, those are those 10 things.
Thank you, Swami.
When consciousness envelops the object and knowledge of the object arises, seer and the seen difference drops. Could you elaborate on that a bit? Okay. So all of us know that by itself the mind has no capability of knowing anything because the mind is inert, jadavastu it is. So then how is knowledge arising in this mind? In the inert it cannot arise. But the mind has a special capability because it is made up of the five subtle elements. Tanmatras. It is made up of five subtle elements, space, air, fire, water, earth, which have not gone through panchikarana, meaning grossification. So the subtle body, mind, intellect, memory, ego, it has a special capability because of the five elements that when the consciousness reflects in this mind, this reflection of consciousness is called chidabhas. This chidabhas empowers this mind to know. And so in general, we say that the mind knows the world of objects. But technically, if you see, it is this chidabhas which is riding through the mind, through the senses, and recognizing the object, and the knowledge is arising in the mind. Because it is the reflection of consciousness which is empowering the mind as well as the body, as well as the senses, as well as the object outside. And so we say that the consciousness riding on the mind goes out through the senses, envelopes the object, and the knowledge of the self, knowledge of the object will arise. In this, we have forgotten consciousness. So we think that I am knowing. So we have created difference between I, the seer, and the object which is the seen. But it is actually consciousness alone which is manifesting as this I also, which is manifesting as the object also. So when this consciousness is going out, enveloping, knowledge is arising, at that time, the difference of the seer and the seen is gone because it is actually only consciousness which is doing the whole thing. Reflection of consciousness, which is manifesting through empowering the BMI to perceive. So when that moment of knowledge that this is a computer, when that moment of knowledge is rising, that subject-object division, that I am the subject which is inside, this is an object which is outside, that difference goes away. Otherwise knowledge cannot arise. The knowledge that this is a computer is arising where? In the mind. At that time in the mind when the knowledge is rising, there is no division that I am Mr. So-and-so and there is no outside. Though the eyes are seeing it outside, the difference of inside-outside goes, difference of subject-object goes, only that vritti is there that this is a computer. That's how it is that the knowledge arises and the distinction of subject and object goes away. But this happens so subtly and so fast that we don't recognize the process. Like how the movie, you know, in the movie, if you see the whole movie, so much of motion we see in the movie, action we see in the movie. But actually they are all still images. And these still images are, you know, projected at a fast pace, maybe, I don't know, 25, 30 stills per image, per minute or per second, not per minute, per second. Then you see movement happening, very subtle. In the same way, the process is happening very fast. So the illusion that we have is, I am experiencing this. So I got the knowledge of this. But at the moment of the knowledge, there is no division of subject and object. Later on, again it rises. And I have got so much knowledge. I have got this. I have learned this. The I thought starts popping up again. But at the moment of knowledge, the I thought is not there. The ego is not there. So we continue on Monday. Om Purnamada Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate Om Shanti 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 Hari Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha Hari Om.